Hello everyone. In this video, we will talk about the processor data path, and we will also talk about the pipeline and how to make the processor more efficient, the pipeline technology for processor design. And we will then introduce the issues, the design problems for using pipeline. So we actually have two types of hazards. We call them data hazards or control hazards. And then this is the different topics we want to include in slide 6. So this is a super important part of the whole semester. So you will for sure see a lot of problems from this chapter in your midterm exam, in final exam. By the way, I'm planning to give you a little bit more information for the midterm exam. Maybe by the end of this week, we will talk more about the midterm exam's requirement. But for sure, you will have an open book, open note, open computer, open internet midterm exam. So it is a take-home midterm exam for sure. So, and then we will talk about the requirement for the midterm exam sometime later this week, but have to emphasize chapter four, data path of the processor. This chapter in your textbook, number two, the computer organization and the design. So this chapter is really important. So it will be included in your future exams and final exam as well. Midterm exam and final exam as well. So I have listed the basic topic for this slide and also marked this is from chapter two, chapter four of your second textbook. And this is the textbook, remember. So that's the name of the textbook. All right. So first of all, so we have introduced quite a few different instructions and you have used many different instructions in your labs. But the most important instruction as I keep emphasizing that, so is ADD, load, store, BEQ. So I know the jump instruction is also really important. But if I want to pick four most important instruction, then it will be ADD, load, store, and BEQ. If I want to pick three most important instruction, it will be ADD, load, and BEQ. So that will be the most typical instructions, right? So why we want to reveal this? Because those are like the different things my CPU or my computer could do. My CPU could do, the computer could do, right? And if I want to design the circuit, the real architecture of the CPU, so which is my processor's architecture. If I want to design the processor architecture, then I have to make sure I could do ADD, I could do load, I could do BEQ, for example, right? The more instruction you have, then the more complex instruction, the more complex architecture you have, the more complex architecture you have. And let's have a quick review of what's the most important things in the processor, how a CPU could look like, how a computer could look like. Well, we do have input device, output device, like your keyboard, your screen. We do have a main memory. Right, which is the RAM. I do have some other memory, other storage, like the hard disk, right? And we do also have a data bus and the control. So the five most important parts of a computer is considered to be input, output, memory, data bus, and control. So the first three are easy to understand. And why I have data bus and control serve as the fourth and the fifth most important elements of a computer, because the design of the data bus, the design of the control unit actually determines how the CPU look like, how how the CPU looks like. So inside of your CPU, you have a bunch of different devices, a few different elements in it, right? And in general, we could understand this as, we could understand, well, the whole CPU could be determined by the structure of the data bus and by the structure of the control unit. And of course, we do have a control unit inside of the CPU. We also have an ALU serve as the basic calculation circuit, And we have a few registers as the temporary storage, to hold the value, we want to calculate, right? And then how the data is moved among the different pieces inside of the CPU, that's considered as the data bus. So how data is moved or transmitted among the different pieces, among the different devices inside CPU. So this is called data bus. And that basically means what's going on here, what's going on in this big circle in this CPU, right? And today we will look at how the data bus look like, what is the data bus, and how to make this efficient. So we will introduce the concept of pipeline, which is a really important concept for modern computer design. And then some of you, especially for whoever took my 1400, then you already learned this in your 1400, but some of you didn't learn this in your 1400. So no matter if you learned it or you haven't learned it, this is really important concept. So we'll go through that in this slide. And again, it will be tested in your future exam. All right, so how the processor look like. If I want to draw a few most important pieces, then I have to have the memory. But to make the thing like clear, if I want to determine the whole structure of the processor, then to make things look really clear, so I want to separate the instruction memory with the data memory. And if you still remember, those two are actually just the two different pieces in your whole RAM, in your whole big memory. Remember in our previous lab, so we do have like data segment, we do have text segment. So the instructions are basically stored in the instruction memory, which is called text segment. And the data part are actually stored, in the data segment. So we call them data memory. And I, of course, should have ALU serve as the basic calculation device. And I also have the registers. Inside of the CPU to perform basic temporary storage, And if you still remember, if I want to execute anything, then I need to have a program counter. What is a program counter? So the program counter holds the address of the instructions. And by checking the program counter's value, then we know which instruction we need to execute. And there's another two piece here, like some additional hardware for help us to add the address, because we keep adding the address with the base address in of the offset. So when we perform load, for example, then you do have a base address and you have a, offset. So you do need to have addition for a lot of situation, such as you are adding a two address, such as you are adding the PC value by 4, and each time when you try to execute the next instruction, then we need to add the PC value by 4 to point to the next instruction in my current memory, right? Instruction memory. So when you move to the next instruction, then we need to increase the PC value by 4. So a lot of the time we do need to do addition. A lot of the time we do need to do addition. So it's not surprising that we do have some adder inside of the processor. We do have some adder inside of the processor. And the sign extension here, remember we do have a lot of immediate number inside of the instruction. Sometimes they're 16 bits instruction, right? So like this immediate number, that's this immediate number inside of the instruction. It is only a 16 bits immediate number. It is only 16 bit immediate number. And if you want to have a 32 bits immediate number, then you have to extend this. You have to do a sign extension because this could be a number. Assign the number, a negative number. This could be a negative number. Then you have to do the sign extension, right? And sometimes you pad a zero, sometimes you pad a few one. So we have to have sign extension. So those are the basic pieces inside of a processor. So how we connect them, and for sure, well, this ALU should be something in the middle, if I guess, because I need to have different things connected to ALU, and I can add them, I can subtract them, I can do different types of calculation. And so usually you should have the register file connected to the ALU, because you can take your value from the register, just like when we do ADD, right? So you have registers S0, register S1, and those inputs come from the register, and you need to use ALU to perform addition, right? So then, so it's not surprising if I make such connection, connect the register file to the ALU. And then later on, after you finish the addition, then your register, the results should be saved into another register. So then my ALU result could go back to the register, right? So this is like to have a simple guess if I want to do ADD, right? So of course, sometimes I want to do load, LW, load. Suppose I'm doing load, and then what I could have is like a register value serve as a base address, and I could have an offset value, and altogether I need to add the number 4 by the content of $S0, and I need to use it as an address, right? And I need to load a piece of data from that address and put it into a certain register. So to complete the load, what should I do? Well, again, I will be able to use ALU because I need to add those two number. And after I add those two number, I need to read the memory because that piece of data is inside of the data memory. And then I need to take the data from the data memory and put it back into the register. So it might be like, oh, I should connect my data memory to the register, and also I need to connect the ALU. I need to connect the ALU to data memory as well, because I need to use ALU to generate this address, and I need to use it as an address. So I need to have the ALU connected to the data memory as well, right? So if you're trying to make the structure of this, it could be super complex, but immediately we know that we do have a few pieces that are really important. So the ALU serve as the center of the calculation center, right? So serve as the calculation center. And you have two pieces of memory. So every instruction should start with the instruction memory. So we first need to take the instruction out from the instruction memory, and the ALU serve as the calculation engine or the calculation center. And then later on, we might have the ALU result used for different purpose. It might go back to the register, it might go to the memory, right? And then you might be able to take a piece of data from the memory and then put it back to the register. So how it will look like? It actually looks like this. So a brief figure. So this is a really a draft version of the structure for your processor. So it will look like this. So all the instructions, they are taken from the instruction memory, So this should be our starting point. The instruction memory should be our starting point because all the instructions come from the instruction memory. And as I told you, well, if I want to do ADD or some general calculation, then I do need to take the data from the register, and then I need to connect them as the input to the ALU. And after ALU finish certain calculations such as the ADD, then you could take the result, and put it back into the register, Or maybe you're trying to perform load, then your ALU calculated an address. So it is only an address. So your ALU result might serve as an address instead of a piece of data if you're doing load. If we're doing load, then we should have a base address added by the offset number. So to generate that number, it is actually using the ALU. And the ALU result is actually an address, but not a piece of data, it is an address. So we should connect that to the data memory and use it as the address. And then we need to take the data from that location. And put it back into a certain register, for example, right? So your data memory could have an output and go back to the register file. So what is the two addition here? Why you need two pieces of adders? For example, if we need to execute any instruction, then we need to look at the PC value, right? So the PC value is actually telling us where it is inside of the memory, instruction memory. So the PC value serves as an address, And later on, after you finish your current instruction, then the PC value has to be updated. So how about if I want to use a hardware to update the PC value, then I need to have an adder. So the PC value should go to the adder, and I should have another constant number 4. So I can add this PC value by constant number 4. And what will come out here, it will be PC plus 4. So the PC plus 4 can be later used as an updated value of the PC. So we could update the value of PC by adding 4 to it. However, there's another instruction called BEQ, and there's a lot of similar branching instructions as well. So for those branching instructions, when I have a BEQ, then what does the BEQ do? So the BEQ actually try to tell the CPU we need to change to another location. So my next instruction being executed is not guided by PC plus 4. It will be guided by your BEQ label, right? So your BEQ really have a label. And then when you have a label, the label is actually a constant number stored in the instruction. And what is that called? It is called immediate number, if you still remember. So the format of the immediate number. Immediate type instruction is this one, right? So the label will be eventually translated into a 16-bit immediate number inside of the instruction. And then how the hardware use the label. So the label is actually a a few bits data coming out from the instruction, coming out from the instruction. The label is actually a piece of constant value. It's a piece of data coming out from the instruction. Where is the instruction? The instruction is inside of the instruction memory. And then we need to use this label, which is a 16-bit data, to determine the final PC value because we're trying to update the PC. For BEQ instruction, the goal of the BEQ instruction is try to update the PC value. And then how we generate the target PC value, we need to use this label as an offset. And we add PC by we add the PC plus 4, which is the next instruction, by the label value. So the label value is actually stored as an offset, inside of the instruction. So we were discussing this a few lectures before, if you still remember, when we talk about BEQ branching instructions. So the label value eventually will be translated as an offset inside of the instruction. And we take the 16 bits out from the instruction, and add it by PC plus 4, and that will eventually generate the target PC value. So that actually means your target PC value could be generated by either PC plus 4, or it could be generated by PC plus 4 plus the label value, So what does that mean? That means you have two different options. How to update the PC? You could use the purple line, maybe pink line, and you could also use the yellow line. You can also use the yellow line. So there's two different ways we update the PC. And also, as you if you remember, so we were just now talking about the ALU's output. So the ALU output could be adding two numbers, just like ADD does. So adding two numbers, and both of the number come from the register, and then you could generate a value using ALU, and the ALU final output will be used to update the register. So you could have an output of the ALU and go back. So you could have the output of the ALU and go back to the register, So this is one type of data you could go you could feed into the register file. And another types of the data that you could feed into the register file is, suppose we're performing load. So we can take a piece of data from a certain memory address, and that piece of data will eventually go back to the register file. So what does that mean? So both the yellow line and the pink line go back to the register. So you have two different options to update a register. What should we do with that? Can you just connect those two wires together? So I have a T connection here. I have another T connection here. Can I just connect the wires? Of course not. It will cause some problem if you connect a different signal just like that. And then how do you know which one you use? So we of course need to add a certain switch. So that will be one switch here, And if you still remember, there's another small tricky things. When you have the ALU, sometimes you need to add a base address by a constant number, and your input to the ALU is one register, one constant number. If you're performing ADD, then your inputs to the ALU, both of them, they are registers. So your ALU could have two different types of inputs, So one come from a register, one come from the instruction, constant number. So if I have both the pink line and the, I should not use this color, both the pink line and the yellow line. So they serve as the input of the second input of the ALU. Then there's another problem here. So you have to have one more switch, So we have three switches inside of this big picture, And those kind of like the traffic light, and to determine, am I using this data or this data? Right? So they're just trying to control the traffic, the data traffic. And this is how the processor should look like. Okay? So I do require everybody to memorize this figure. This is the simplest version of the processor architecture. And you do have like a more complex version with a lot of more detail. That will be this figure. But I do not require you to know this, okay? So I'll take a note here. I do not require all details. I do not require you to know all the details inside of this figure. A lot of you might know this from my 1400 already, which is really good. But if you don't understand all the detail here, you should at least understand the detail. So it is required, this figure. That means you will have problems related of this figure. You will have problem related to this figure in your midterm exams, in your final exams. You have to be able to analyze such figure. You have to be able to analyze or describe the structure of the processor. And we call it a data bus. So why we call it a data bus? Because this figure basically shows how the data is moved around from different pieces of the processor. And it does include all the different pieces of the processor, okay? There's one more detail we want to add here is, well, how you implement the switch. If you want to have a switch, how you implement the switch. So we do not have a real switch in the circuit. It must be a piece of circuit or like certain device, and it is called multiplexer or MUX. And some of you remember this from your 1400. If you do not remember, that's okay. So it's kind of like a piece of circuit serve as a selection device. What it does is selecting one of the input and transmit only one of the input, use it as the output. So if I select the number one, then the output will be number one. If I select number two, then the output will be equal to number two. But it only selects one of them at certain time. It only selects one of them at certain time. So that's called MUX. Okay. So instead of using a switch, then we do have a MUX. And then a little bit more detailed version of the previous figure will look like this. And you also see, well, there's some more detail added here, like shift by two. So what does that mean? So it actually helps us to perform the detail calculation of the PC. So if you still remember, the overall structure is still the same. So you have a register file, you have a data memory, you have instruction memory, you have the ALU. The ALU serve as the calculation center, and then your data could come out from the register. Your data could come from part of your instruction. But if it's coming out from part of the instruction, and of course isn't like a short data, it could be 16 bits only, and you want to do some extension to make it to be 32 bits long. If you have two 32 bits long data, one come from the PC plus four, one come from the instruction, and you might be able to add them together. And instead of using the adder, you could reuse the you could actually reuse the, let's say just keep it using an adder. So you could use an adder, you could use an adder to add those two pieces of data together and generate your final result, generate your final result. However, there's a trick designed by the MIPS instruction. Suppose we're trying to calculate the BQ, implement the BQ instruction. So the PC should be calculated by taking 16 bits from the instruction, and it is the median number, and you do sine extension to make it to be 32 bits data. And you also want to shift it by 2 because the lower 2 bits are always 0 for you to calculate any target address. The lower 2 bits are always 0. So you want to shift it by 2, and you add the PC plus 4, which is your next instruction's address, and you add it by the offset, and you will generate the final PC value. So this is actually a little bit more detail how we implement the BEQ. However, this is and this could be a little bit different for each different processor, for each different processor. For MIPS, particularly for MIPS, then we do have exactly the same feature like inside of this figure, inside of this figure. So how about those blue lines? Remember, inside of the whole processor, there's the most important part is called control unit. And we didn't draw the control unit in this big picture, right? So suppose the control unit is a piece of blue circuit, so with the blue color. So I have one piece of circuit, it's called the control unit. It's called the control unit. And adding the control unit to my big picture, it will make the whole picture complete. But the control unit is, of course, connected to all the different pieces here, right? So the blue lines, 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 you could weld them as the wires that connected to the CPU, the wires that connected to the CPU. So the CPU, so to the CU, to the control unit. So the CU basically sends out all the blue lines serve, and all the blue lines serve as control signals. Control signals. So if the CU, the control unit, could send out proper control signals to control each piece of this circuit, then the whole circuit could work as a well-controlled sequential logic circuit. So then you can use different pieces at different time, and you can also transmit the data from one piece to another piece inside of the whole timeline. Inside of the whole timeline. And suppose if I want to separate this big picture into a few different stages, and suppose I want to use the name stage. Oh, oops. Is that right? Stages? Yes. So if I want to separate, divide this big processor into a few different stages, and along the timeline. So initially, first of all, everything starts with getting an instruction. So if you have a lot of instructions to execute, but to execute each instruction, we always need to get the instruction from the instruction memory, So this is our first step. And after we got the instruction, then the CU, so I should have my CU here. CU. So control unit sends control signals, sends all the blue signals. So how can the control unit send out the control signals? After we got the instruction is of course connected, fit into the control unit, fit into the control unit. And then the control unit could look at the instruction. And if the control unit understand the instruction, then of course the control unit could determine proper control signals to control all the different pieces in this figure, right? So the second step is always, ask the control unit to translate the instruction and send out proper control signal. At the same time, the control unit also could tell the register, well, I need register one, I need register two, because they are like the data serve as the input of the ADD, for example. So the second stage, it could be translate, or we can call it decode the instruction. At the same time, then we know what kind of data we need to as the input of the ALU. So the third stage, I think you all know that. It will be the ALU need to perform the calculation. So the third stage is, well, everything is ready. So ALU can simply perform the calculation. Either you could add two numbers from the register, or you can add one number from a constant from the instruction and another number from a register, just like when we are performing load. So you could have one number come from a register, and the other number is the constant number coming out from the instruction. So the third step is let ALU to perform the calculation. So the fourth step, suppose your ALU calculated address, and then the address will be connected to the data memory, right? So you need to use it to get a piece of data from the data memory. So the fourth stage is getting a piece of data from the data memory. And if you got a piece of data from the data memory, you need to put it back into the register, just like when we are trying to do load, right? So if I get a piece of data from the data memory, I need to put it back to my register. So I have to put a 5 here, but you know, where is the 5? It's actually here, going back to the register, right? So it is actually, so the first stage is here, second stage stop here, third stage stop here after the ALU, and the fourth stage stop after the data memory access. And the fifth stage actually goes from the data memory back to the register file. So that is called 5. And they won't, if I use a little bit clear. Note, it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that, right? And then you will have a question, well, why you keep using load as the example? If you are performing something else, then of course you do not need to have such a complex data path, right? So the meaning of data path here is how the data is moved around. And suppose we're doing a load, then we start with getting a piece of instruction, number one, and then we take the data from the register, we take another data from the instruction, we add those two together. So take the data and understand the instruction, that's the number two stage. And the third stage is using ALU to add the offset to the register number, to the register content. The third stage is adding the constant number from the instruction to the register content. So that will be ALU calculation as my third stage. And number four will be I generated the target address by adding the constant number to the register content, and that serves as an address, so I need to read it from the data memory. So number four, the fourth stage is the data memory access. Memory access. And number five, the last stage will be, I get a piece of data from the memory and I need to put it back into the register. So suppose I add one new slide here just to make everything clear. For me to perform load, suppose the format of my current instruction look like this. And I want to load this data and from the this address and put it into $T0. So I will have five steps. Step one is get this instruction from the instruction memory. And number two will be let the control unit decode the instruction. And at the same time, I know I should take the value of S0, so the value of that register will get ready. And number three will be ALU perform addition. And the two input of the ALU, one is coming out from register S0. The other one is the constant number four. So the constant number four is from the instruction. So number four, the fourth stage will be, well, if you add S0 by four, then that will basically give you an address for you to load the data. So you have the address ready. So then you need to read the memory. To get that piece of data. From which location? That will be generated by your ALU result. And this is actually the memory address. So if after I get access to the memory, I get that piece of data, then the number five, last stage will be, I need to put this piece of data back into a register. Which register? $T0. Right. So this is actually writing the register file. So by looking at this page, the quick note tells me for me to implement a load instruction, I actually use every piece of this figure. So you need to have instruction memory register file, ALU, data memory. You need to perform calculation. Of course, for every instruction, you always need to update your PC. So that's by default true for each instruction. So I actually implemented load using the previous figure, and each piece of the hardware was used. And I have to tell you, LW is the most important instruction. Also, it is the most complex instruction for a CPU because you have a really complex data bus. So the data bus for load actually start with number one here and got the data from the register and from the instruction. So the data come into the ALU, and then you get the ALU result, and then the ALU result go to the data memory server as an address. And then you take a piece of data out from the memory, and then you move it back to the register. So this is how the data is moved around from each piece of hardware inside of this figure. So that's why we call this figure as the data bus. It's not actually this figure is the data bus. It's using this figure you could analyze. The data bus for each instruction. And the load instruction is the most complex instruction, which actually goes through each stage using each piece of hardware inside of this figure. So if I can copy this and this figure, duplicate, paste. Paste it again. So we just want to have a quick analysis. Suppose we're not trying to implement load. Suppose we're trying to implement ADD. What will happen? What will happen? Again, I can still separate this whole figure into a few steps. I should actually call that a few stage, right? So stage one is get the instruction. Stage two is decode the instruction, translate the instruction. Stage three is using ALU to perform calculation. Stage four is get access to the memory. Stage five is write the data back to the register. So suppose this is the whole figure and my goal is trying to implement ADD. So my goal is trying to implement, ADD. $S0, $S1, $S2. Suppose this is my goal. So how can I implement this ADD instruction? Of course, we start with number one. We get the instruction from instruction memory, and then we have the two registers used as the input of the ALU. So number two is decoding the ADD instruction and we figure out, oh, I need S1, S0. And then I use those two as my input to the ALU. And number three should be using ALU. So if I use the blue, maybe I should use another color, orange color. So I use orange color to indicate how the data come out. So I should start with PC. PC tells me I have this instruction. Instruction come out, and I could connect this to the control union, but you don't have to draw this. So I just want to give you more information. And then we know, okay, after we decode the instruction, we know the two inputs of the ALU come from register. And then the ALU result will be generated. However, the ALU result is not an address now. It is not an address now. The ALU result for this particular example should go back to the register file directly, because after you add S0 by S1, then you should put them back to S2. And you don't need to connect to the memory, data memory. You don't need to connect to the data memory. So I have to clear this part. So the ALU result need to go back to the register. Instead of go to the data memory, you should go back to the register file. So this is how a data bus could be illustrated or could be drawn out. So if I will ask you to draw the data bus for a certain instruction, you should be able to draw it. Right? So they different instructions have different data paths. So this is the most complex data path should be the data path for load, because we're using all the different stages, all the different devices inside of the whole figure, And then this is the data path for, so the orange color serve as the data path for the ADD, right? So how it look like? Well, you don't need the actually to get access to the memory. You need to skip this step. You need to skip the fourth step. You don't need to actually go to the data memory. You just need to go back to the register file, right? So for different instruction, the data path will look different, the data path will look different. This is the detailed figure with the control union in it. So remember, we didn't have the control union in the previous figures. And I told you this is not required, but you should know this is the complete figure, how it should look like, how it should look like. All right, so we have already analyzed that there's five different stages inside of the processor, five different stages inside of the processor, right? So we actually used two different examples. One is load, one is ADD. One is load, one is ADD. Now try to understand how the data was moved around. So there's actually one more example. If I can duplicate this again. Suppose we're trying to analyze BQ. And how the data path should look like. Again, I will need to separate each step. So number one, number two, number three, number four, number five, five different stages. And if I'm trying to do BEQ, $S0, $S1, remember this is how it looks like. And we need to determine the final PC value according to the label. And however, the BEQ does not only simply determine the label by looking at the label value. You also need to compare those two values, remember, right? So you also need to compare $S0, $S1, what's the value of them? How can I compare them? Which piece of hardware should I use to compare two pieces of registers? So of course, there's only one thing I can use to perform certain calculation. That's called the ALU. So we could actually using ALU to subtract the value of S0 and S1, and then you should know they're equal or not. Then you could know they're equal or not. Excuse me. So if I use ALU to subtract S0, S1, then I know if they're equal or not. So immediately after my ALU gave me the result, then I should be able to update the PC. So if I try to analyze how the data was transmitted, I'm more curious about like, okay, so again, we start with the PC and I got the instruction. So the instruction will also go to the control unit. And then I need to use two registers, right? Because I have two registers to subtract. And I will use ALU to perform the calculation. After ALU finish the calculation, then the PC will be updated. So I'm actually done. As long as I could finish the ALU calculation. Because I do not need to get access of the data memory, because I do not need to write back to the register. So I don't actually want, I don't actually have anything to do with step four and five. So I just want to let you know that for different instruction, we do have different data paths. So the orange color I mark out here, serve as the data path for BEQ, And of course, this is different with ADD. So you see the difference. And this is also different with load. So suppose I want to use orange color again to mark out the load. So we still start with the PC and got So if I have to write the instruction out, then it will be load. A particular example, right? So I need to get the instruction out from the memory, instruction memory, and then the CU translate the instruction, and figure out, oh, this is a load, so your first input to the ALU come from a register, which is your $S0. And the second input of the ALU come from the immediate number. And your ALU result will be connected to the data memory because it serves as an address. You need to read that piece of data from the memory. So you will get a piece of data from the memory, and you need to put that piece of data back. Back into the register. So this is the complete data pass. This is the complete data pass for the load. So if you compare the orange line for load, the orange line for ADD, the orange line for BEQ, they're all different because they do have different data pass. All right, so that's about what is data pass. This is like the most important concept for this chapter. So officially, we do have different names for those five stages. The first stage is called instruction fetch. It is basically taking the instruction out from the instruction memory. And the second stage is called ID, instruction decode. And at the same time, we do need to read the data from the register. And the third stage is called EX, execution. So we execute different operation according to different instruction using ALU. So the fourth stage is called memory access. So usually it is represented by MEM, memory access. Usually it is represented by MEM. The last stage is called write back. So if you have something coming out from the data memory and you need to write it back to the register, then you need to have WB, you need to execute WB, write back. So those five stages are always there for each instruction, but it doesn't mean that you have to go through all of them. Yeah. So what does that mean? So you will see a figure later on. But in general, different instructions have different things to do, right? So like the BEQ instruction, you need to do stage 1, 2, 3. You also have stage 4 and 5, but you actually is not doing anything. So for a load instruction, then you have stage 1 to 5. But it actually doesn't mean that each instruction they are same, right? So how about if you have store? So if I look at the, so I forgot the ADD. So for the ADD instruction, then you do need to have the five stages are always there, but you're not actually using all of them. So it kind of like it still start with the instruction fetch, and then you do the instruction translation. So we call it instruction decoding, and then we do the ALU calculation. We call it execution, and then we need to write it back. So we need to execute stage 5, but we don't have anything to do in stage 4. Because we are not reading anything from the data memory. So why we need to define those stages and what's the usage of them? So for a particular example, a real practical example, suppose we have a MIPS processor, And each stage costs different amount of time, Instruction fetch costs us 200 PS. So picosecond. Register read or instruction decoding ID, the second stage, cost us 100 PS. And the third stage, which is instruction execution, cost us 200 PS. And the fourth stage, is the memory access. Cost us 200 PS. And the last stage, the memory access cost us 200 PS. It is right, 200 PS. And the last stage, if you need to write back, then it cost you 100 PS. So why they cost a different amount of time? Of course, suppose you are trying to access a memory, then it is a little bit slower. It is a little bit slower than reading something from the register, right? So the read the register costs us 100 PS, then read the memory costs us 200 PS. And in reality, it might be even more than that. So you have different amount of time needed for a different stage. And the load basically goes through every stage. So the real time we actually need for ADD, for example, you're not doing anything in the fourth stage. So if you're doing ADD, you're not doing anything in the fourth stage. If you're doing BEQ, you're not doing anything in the fourth, the fifth stage. If you're doing stall, this will be left to you as a practice. So you are not actually doing anything for last stage because you need to put things into the memory and then you're done. You don't need to write back to the register. But you always need the first column, the second column, the third column. If we're only trying to implement load store ADD and BEQ, right? So which is really interesting. So if this is the case, then we really want to analyze how can I be more efficient? So it's kind of like you're cooking different things. Suppose you are making a cake and you may need use 5 stage. Suppose you are making a soup, you may need use 3 stage. Suppose you are making a stir fry dish, then you may need 4 stages, right? Because you need a different amount of time. You need to use different pieces of the hardware, So you technically need different amount of time to do different things. And then if I want to be more efficient, then I can do all of them together, right? It may be possible. It may be possible for me. So a terminology here is called length of the clock cycle, TC. Pretty often it is represented by TC, and I hope you could still remember this from your first quiz. So what is the clock cycle time? So it is like the full cycle of implementing the longest data pass, okay? It is the full cycle. It is the full cycle to go through the longest data pass. Or you could view it as the slowest instruction. Who is our slowest instruction? Load, right? For me to complete everything in load, that will be the longest data pass, I need to go through. So that will cost me 800 PS, and that is my clock cycle time, So if I use a single clock cycle processor, that means I need to determine a clock cycle time that actually could be able to finish everything. And it has to be the longest, has to be the most complex instruction as long as the most complex instruction. It has to be as long as the slowest instruction, because I cannot make my clock cycle shorter than that. If I make my clock cycle shorter than that, I will be not able to finish the load, right? So how can I be more efficient? I think you are already thinking about this question. So if you are using different amount of time, you are using different piece of the hardware. So if you want to do the different things together, then you can reuse the different hardware, right? Just like the idea coming from when we are doing laundry, for example. So we may want to use the washer, we may want to use the dryer, and we could do washing for my first step, drying for my second step, folding for my third step after my take out the clothes from the dryer and I need to fold them. So folding can be my third step, and then storing, so I need to put them back to the closet, so it will be my last step. So if I have four different stages and I keep do this laundry work again, 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 and again, suppose I do it four times, and then for the regular operation could be washing, drying, folding, storing, washing, drying, folding, storing, washing, drying, folding, storing, washing, drying, folding, storing. So you are already like, oh, that's so efficient. And if it not, that's not efficient, of course, right? Sound like, oh, you're not doing a really efficient job. So why it is not efficient? Because you keep doing, you know, when you do the washing, then your dryer is empty. And then you're not having anything on your folding station, and you do not have anything happening in your closet, right? If you're doing the drying, then your washer is empty, or washer is empty, and there's nothing going on in the folding station, there's nothing going on in the closet, right? So how about to stack them together? So if I stack them together, then I can first start with washing of my first load, And then after the washer finish washing, then I could immediately start the washing for my second load. I can immediately start the washing for my second load. And after my dryer finished the drying, I could immediately start the washing for my third load. Why am I doing that? Because as long as my washer is empty, then I can feed new things in it. As long as my dryer is empty, I can feed new things in it, right? So I don't have to wait. So when I look at this whole flow chart, the flow of the work task, then at a certain time, ideally you want to do everything all together. So ideally you want to do everything all together. So you want to have your closet performing storing. You want to have your folding station to perform folding. And you want to have your dryer to perform drying. You want to have your washer to perform washing all at the same time, right? So this is called pipeline. Well, that's idea. The idea here is really straightforward. This is everything we do all the time. So when you cook at home, then you also, you know, do something else altogether, right? When you're playing with your kids, and at the same time, you might be able to do cleaning because you want to be parallel. So a good question to ask is, you said you are more efficient, but how efficient you are. So that will be your speed up. Right? So the speed up could be definitely calculated, if you still remember, this is what you did in your first quiz. So the speed up is generated using the longer time divided by the shorter time. So we have a magic equation. The speed up equals the longer time divided by the shorter time. And how long is the longer time? It will be, if I consider each machine or each stage costs me one time unit, then it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4 equals 16 time units. And then the second version only costs me 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4 plus 1, plus 2, plus 3. So it will be 4 plus 3, which is 7. So the overall speed up is 16 divided by 7, which is about 4. Which is about 2.3. So that's the speed up. All right. And then a really good question we want to consider is how big the speed up could be if you want to always do the pipeline. So then we need to look at this real example. So the real example, instead of using the laundry example, then we're using a processor. So we have 5 different stages in the processor, and they're like instruction fetch, register, read register, ALU calculation, data access, write back to register. So each of them costs different amount of time. And if I stack them together, then I have to make sure the longest stage gets stacked, right? So even you have like a shorter amount of time needed for a second stage, if you want to stack them together, then you still need to cost 200 PS. Still need to cost 200 PS because you want to reuse the hardware, right? So you can't stack things as tight as you can. You cannot stack things as tight as you can because you want to reuse the hardware. You have to, you know, finish the usage of the hardware before you load new things in it. So the smallest time unit, it will be 200 PS, right? And then the question will be, how big is your speed up? Right? So then we need to analyze the longer time, the shorter time. So how big is your longer time and how big is your shorter time? And then if we could finish that, and then we know, you know, how to calculate the speed up. So So I will put the answer of this page here. The longer time basically means how many instructions you have. Each of them cost 800 PS. So suppose the number of instructions we have is defined by number of IC. So it will be that means the number of instructions. So it's panda IC. Panda IC means number of instruction count. This is a little bit confusing. Let me write. So number of instructions we have to execute, to run, we call it IC, instruction count. All right, so then the longer time we are interested to calculate the speed up equals the longer time divided by the shorter time. And the longer time equals IC multiply 800, so the cycle time, 800 PS. And the shorter time, I need to look at that. How can I calculate the shorter time? So I have 200 here, 200 here, 200 here again. And you may have many, many instructions. But eventually you will have one last instruction here, and that will cost you 800 PS if you look at the last one here, right? So suppose you have 4 of them
then you will only need to do, you will only need to do 800 plus 3 additional, and each of them you need to multiply 200, right? So if you have 4 instructions, it will be 800 plus 4 minus 1 times 200. If you have 5 instructions, then it will be 5 minus 1 times 200 plus 800. If you have 6 instructions, then you will have to have 6 minus 1 times 200 plus 800. So you always have 800 plus IC minus 1 times 200. Right. So this is how we calculate the shorter time. And then I'm curious about what the thing will generate. So let me try to simplify a little bit. So it will be 800 times IC, and this one will be 200 times IC plus 800 minus 200. And when the IC goes really high, is a big number. In reality, the number of instruction is really a big number, like a million, right? So you might have millions of instructions, right? So when you have a lot of instruction to execute, then this speed up is actually easy to calculate, because that will be 800 divided by 200. That will be almost 800 divided by 200, because the IC number here is really big, and then you really don't care this constant value. It is a relatively really small tiny value you added to this part. So this is a really tiny small value. You don't want to count it, right? So this is actually 800 divided by 200 is actually how many stages you have. About how many let me see. Did I make any? Right. So it is how about, it is about how many, we should see, well, it is about it's not how many stages. Let's see, later on we'll see more example. We'll see more example, but we know, suppose the longest time of one stage. So this will be the longest time of one stage. And this is the TC, clock cycle time. And if you divide the clock cycle time by the longest time of one stage, and you get this number. And this number tells you how big is your speed up. How big is your speed up? And ideally, how this number could be? Well, ideally, suppose I have each of my stage, they're equal to each other, right? Ideally, I can have each of my stage equal to each other. So then I have, I don't have this kind of big gap. I don't have this kind of big gap, right? So what will happen? Then this will be the number of stage. Ideally, this will be the number of stage. All right, so this is the conclusion we could come out. What does that mean? So if I want to make a pipeline processor, that will be, of course, speed up the whole process, and I can make a more efficient implementation, right? So I can actually spend
much less time compared with the non-pipeline processor. But how efficient you can be? How efficient can be? Well, it depends on your pipeline design. It depends on the pipeline design. If you have the pipeline designed with each of the stage, you know, is equally has equal length with each other. So each of the stage has equal length with each other. And you have many, many stages, And then your pipeline processor will be super efficient because you want this number as big as you can. You want this number 4 as big as you can. How can you make that number 4 bigger? You could make this 200 as small as you can. So if you make this longest time of one stage, a really tiny small number, then basically means you have many, many stages. You have many, many stages, right? So you separate your whole laundry work into quite a few pieces. And then the more you could separate, the more stage you can divide, the more efficient you could be, All right, so this is the lecture for the pipeline. And I hope everybody understand how to calculate the speed up here. And this problem will be, of course, tested in future. And this is a really important concept. All right, we will stop here for this video.